الحمد لله الذي أحصى كل شيء عددا، ورفع بعض خلقه على بعض فكانوا طرائق قددا. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، لم يتخذ صاحبة ولا ولدا، ولم يكن له شريك في الملك ولا يكون أبدا. ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله، أكرم به عبدًا سيدًا، وأعظم به حبيبًا مؤيدًا، فما أزكاه أصلًا ومحتدى، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحابته صلاةً دائمةً وسلامًا مؤبدًا. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون أياما معدودات. صدق الله العظيم. Honorable scholars, respected brothers and elders, very swiftly the first 10 days of Ramadan has slipped through our hands. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our humble efforts inshallah, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us for our weaknesses and mistakes in these 10 days and before that as well inshallah. The ayat kareema I have recited before you, that is inshallah what we will discuss briefly in today's Jumu'ah. Allah Rabbul Izzah says, O you who believe, kutiba alaykum as-siyamu kama kutiba ala alladhina min qablikum. Fasting has been made compulsory upon you just as it had been made compulsory on those that preceded you. So the first thing in this verse that is noteworthy, Allah addresses us with a very honorable title. Allah says, O you who believe. Now, the virtue of this title can be appreciated from the following. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the greatest, and from amongst the bounties that Allah gives, Iman is the greatest bounty. So the greatest being is attributing to you the greatest quality. O you who believe. And it is a direct address from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's an address of love and compassion. Kutiba alaykum as-siyam, fasting has been made compulsory upon you. Kama kutiba ala alladhina min qablikum, just as it had been made compulsory on those that preceded you. This is the first psychological concession that Allah is giving. You're not the first one to fast. Don't think it's the first time there's a nation that is fasting. Many that preceded you also observed this fast. And then Allah highlights the object of this fast, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, so that you can achieve the quality of taqwa. We will explain that inshallah. Then Allah says, أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ. Allah explains the time phrase of this fast. Allah could have said Ramadan is 1 month. Allah did not use the term 1 month. Allah said, أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ. It's a matter of a few days. So this is a second psychological concession that Allah is giving you. Oh, 1 month, 1 whole month, 5 Jummas or 4 Jummas without my dal and rice. Allah said, أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ. It's a matter of few days. So that's the second psychological ease that Allah is creating for you. And then Allah says, the object of this fast is not to keep you hungry. The object of this fast is not to keep you thirsty. The object of this fast is not to tire you by night. The object is لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, to create within you the strength to restrain from vice and sin. That's the object of this fast. The Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كَمْ مِنْ صَائِمٍ لَيْسَ لَهُ مِنْ صِيَامِهِ إِلَّا الظَّمَى وَكَمْ مِنْ قَائِمٍ لَيْسَ لَهُ مِنْ قِيَامِهِ إِلَّا السَّهَرُ. There are many that fast by day, but their fast gets for them nothing but hunger and thirst. May Allah protect us. And there are many that observe the prayers by night, but their prayers by night gets them nothing but tiredness and fatigue. So the object of the fast is what needs to be achieved. And why is fasting so effective in this regard? To create within the person the strength to abstain from the disobedience of Allah. Because for the entire day, you are abstaining from something that is generally permissible. To eat is permissible, to drink is permissible, to indulge in conjugal relations with your partner is permissible. So 3 things that are primarily permissible out of the month of Ramadan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying for a period of time abstain from it. So when you are able to develop the strength of abstaining from something that is lawful generally, all the more you should abstain from something that is haram and forbidden permanently. That's the underlying message of the month of Ramadan. And fasting is very effective in this regard. I know my sins and you know your sins. Each one of us, we have some sins that we are really grappling with. You know, I'm making an effort to come out of it, but for some reason, fasting is the ideal platform. Mishkat Sharif, 2nd volume, 1st hadith, the Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam addressed the companions of the youth. And he said, Ya ma'ashar al-shabab, man istata'a minkum al-ba'ata falyatazawwaj, fa'innahu aghaddu lil-basar wa ahsanu lil-farj. Oh, the group of youngsters, he who is able to wed, let him wed and marry. فَإِنَّهُ أَغَضُّ لِلْبَصَرِ. One of the great benefits of wedding and making nikah is it will help you protect your gaze. If after nikah you're not protecting your gaze, you are defeating yourself of one of the primary benefits of nikah. And Ramadan again is the ideal platform for us to do that exercise. There's a hadith that is really a great motivation for all of us to protect our gaze, inshallah. The Prophet says that Allah Rabbul Izzah says, that person that will lower his gaze for the pleasure of Allah, مَنْ تَرَكَهَا مَخَافَتِي أَبْدَلْتُهُ إِيمَانًا يَجِدُ حَلَاوَتَهُ فِي قَلْبِهِ. I will instantly make him taste the sweetness of Iman. Now, 30 days is the month of Ramadan. The scholars say, add another 10 days. And abandon any sin for 40 days and see the inner solace and comfort that Allah gives you. That's the system of Allah. مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٍ فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبًا. A verse of the 14th juz, Allah Rabbul Izzah says, that person that leads a life of piety and nobility, فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبًا, most certainly we will give him حَيَاتًا طَيِّبًا, a pleasant, peaceful life. The scholars explain and explore what is meant by حَيَاتًا طَيِّبًا. Primarily, it refers to a life of contentment and satisfaction. That you are in peace, you are in harmony, you are in comfort, you are in tranquility. Why? Because you are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As sinful as we are, there is some degree of pleasure for us when we are breaking our fast. They say that's the only adhan that we wait for. Maghrib adhan in Ramadan. So when a person is breaking that fast of his, there is a degree of accomplishment that you feel. That alhamdulillah, by the grace of Allah, I have completed this fast. I have completed this obligation. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said very clearly in the hadith that لِلصَّائِمِ فَرْحَةً فَرْحَةٌ عِنْدَ فِطْرِهِ وَفَرْحَةٌ عِنْدَ لِقَاءِ رَبِّهِ. There are two moments of joy for a fasting person. One is when he breaks his fast. ذَهَبَ الظَّمَأُ وَابْتَلَّتِ الْعُرُوقُ وَثَبَتَ الْأَجْرُ إِنْشَاءَ اللَّهِ. That's the dua that should be recited. And the other moment of happiness is when you meet your Allah. So as sinful as we are, when that obligation is completed and fulfilled, there is a degree of happiness, joy, and jubilation that we've achieved something. Now, can you imagine if our entire life is shaped around the month of Ramadan, that we diligent, how passionate we are to find out the masail, that am I allowed to take this injection? Am I allowed to do this? Will this render my fast void or not? So how passionate we are that we diligently observe this great injunction and obligation of Islam in the correct manner. Let our entire life come onto the method and the tartib of Ramadan. And that is the object of Ramadan, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, so that you develop that inner strength to stay away from the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What happens is the nafs that we have, I can speak for myself, it's ammara. It's constantly provoking us to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah forbid, it reaches a stage that now when you disobey Allah, the level of guilt in your inner heart is also dwindling down and down, and it's withering away. That Allah forbid. Allah says, كلا بل ران على قلوبهم ما كانوا يكسبون. That now there is a seal placed on the heart. There is no room for any guilt to be perceived by that heart, simply because it has been locked and sealed. That's the effect of And I often say, I know my own plight. If it was not for the month of Ramadan, if it was not for the Fridays, if it was not for the occasional Eid prayer, where, what would our condition be? With Ramadan, with Eid, with Fridays, we know where we're standing. Imagine where we would have been without it. So Ramadan is the platform for us to curb this ego within us and this urge to sin, this urge to disobey Allah. And amongst the sins that briefly I wish to say, inshallah we can make an effort to abstain, one is that of zina and adultery. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَأَنْ يُطْعَنَ فِي رَأْسِ أَحَدِكُمْ بِمَخِيطٍ مِّنْ حَدِيدٍ خَيْرٌ لَهُ مِنْ أَنْ يَمَسَّ إِمْرَأَةً لَا تَحِلُّ لَهُ. مَعْقَلْ بِنْ يَسَارَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ narrates the narration. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, O my Sahaba, it is better for you that a steel nail be drilled in the center of your head than touching the hand of a strange woman. When we say strange, we mean غير محرم, a woman that you can get married to. You can't say, no, I know her for many years, she's not strange for me. Strange as in it is permissible for you to marry her. And the very beginning step to protect ourselves from this evil is to protect our gaze. That's the beginning step. This hadith is a great motivation that will taste the sweetness of iman. Mullah Ali Qari rahimahullah says in the commentary of Mishkat Sharif, in his famous commentary known as Mirqat, he says that we have been informed, once the sweetness of iman enters the heart of a person, it never leaves it. That is true pleasure. That is real satisfaction. You know this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that person that says, رَضِينَا بِاللَّهِ رَبَّا وَبِالْإِسْلَامِ دِينَا وَبِمُحَمَّدٍ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ رَسُولًا وَنَبِيًّا. He said, ذَاقَ طُعْمَ الْإِيمَانِ مَنْ رَضِيَ بِاللَّهِ رَبَّا. That person will taste the sweetness of iman. Who has the following three qualities? A, رَضِيَ بِاللَّهِ رَبَّا. He is pleased with Allah as his Lord. وَبِالْ إِسْلَامِ دِينَ. He is pleased with Islam as his religion. وَبِمُحَمَّدٍ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ رَسُولًا وَنَبِيًّا. And he is pleased with Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم as his prophet. Now these three qualities here, you might think, mashallah, we all have it. What is the underlined wisdom in this hadith? The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم did not say that person will taste the sweetness of iman who says Allah is my Lord. He said, man radiya. And the scholars say, rida has a direct link to the heart. That person will taste the sweetness of iman who is satisfied with Allah as his Lord. And the word rida demands that after my iman, if I get nothing, I'm still happy. So if I enjoy nothing besides my iman, my Quran and my Nabi, I'm more than happy. A person that has this degree of satisfaction in his faith, he will certainly taste the sweetness of iman. May Allah grant it to us. So that's a great motivation, that I lower my gaze for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am optimistic, I will taste the sweetness of iman. And that's the first step, that we begin to protect our... When that invitation comes for haram, nobody becomes a wali or saint instantly. You can't just look down and write, okay, for today I'll be Junaid Baghdadi. It's not going to work. There is a build-up of effort. So that when that whisper comes from the devil, you can restrain and withhold yourself. In the commentary of this verse, in the 9th juz of the Quran, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا إِذَا مَسَّهُمْ طَائِفٌ مِّنَ الشَّيْطَانِ تَذَكَّرُوا فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْصِرُونَ. The pious ones, the noble ones, are those that whenever the devil whispers an evil message to their heart, تَذَكَّرُوا, they reflect. فإذا هم مبصرون and they restrain from the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the famous tafsir book of Allama Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, there is an incident mentioned in the commentary of this verse. There was a youngster in the time of Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu, and he would frequent the gathering of Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu. And for some time Umar radiyallahu anhu seen that he was absent, and what would happen that on his path home, on his road home, he would pass by this woman or girl of phenomenal beauty, and she would invite him. So there is no step from his side. This makes it more difficult. That is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, amongst the seven people to enjoy shade under the arsh of Allah, يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ, on that day when there will be no shade but the shade provided by the arsh of Allah. May Allah make us from amongst those fortunate ones. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, رَجُلًا دَعَتْهُ إِمْرَأَةٌ ذَاتُ مَنْصَبٍ وَجَمَالٍ. A person that is invited by a woman of a high lineage and of phenomenal beauty. So that's the qualities that she has. And then he restrains and he says, إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهُ, my iman cannot allow me to indulge. For that moment it's challenging. For that moment it's tough. But wallah, 10 minutes later, once your ego has settled, that night when you retire to bed, I promise you on the name of Allah, there is an inner satisfaction that Allah will grant you. If that's the happiness the same night, you can well imagine what will be the happiness on the day of Qiyamah. That nobody is aware of it, only for the pleasure of my Allah did I restrain. That business deal, that haram offer comes, and it's tempting, and it looks appeasing. Only for the pleasure of my Allah do I restrain, and I stay away from it. It's challenging for that moment, but wallah, Allah will give, that's the promise of Allah, Allah will give you inner satisfaction. And the nature of sin, on the contrary, is you sin, it gives you temporary joy, it gives you temporary happiness. Momentarily you feel a kick, momentarily you feel a thrill, and thereafter it's depression again, it's sadness again. Either you go back and indulge in the same sin, or you go to a sin one further. But there's no inner satisfaction. Inner satisfaction comes with the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this person would frequent that particular road and this woman would invite him. And one day, the devil overpowered him and he entered the house behind this girl. That is why the scholars say, when it comes to the fitna of women, no person remains pious. You don't say, no, he's a saint. This is one fitna where no saint also remains a saint. Abu Huraira makes dua, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min fitnati zina. Allah, I seek your protection from zina. Somebody said, Abu Huraira, wait man. You know, if you don't know who you are, let me tell you who you are. Abdurrahman bin Sakhar, Abu Huraira, the great giant sahabi, who is responsible of narrating 5,374 ahadith to us. Abu Huraira, what are you making? Abu Huraira said, as long as the devil is with me, I do not feel safe from the provocations of the devil. How much effort we need to make? This month of Ramadan is an ideal platform for us to develop that inner taqwa that can enable us and equip us to resist the temptations of the devil. The first thing that we do when that whisper comes, you don't entertain the thought. وَإِمَّا يَنْزَغَنَّكَ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ نَزْغٌ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ. When that evil whisper comes from the devil, فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ, your first step, seek protection in Allah. Recite, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. Go and make wudu and perform two rakats of salah and turn to Allah and ask Allah to protect you. Now you are fortifying yourself with the power of Allah. Now the devil cannot interfere. So the hadith says, فَإِذَا ذَكَرَ اللَّهَ خَنَسَ. The devil will whisper an evil thought. He would wait and see what's your reaction. If you remember Allah, he will retrieve. So your dhikr, your remembrance of Allah is fortifying you against the influence of shaitan. When he sees that you are, you know, the devil runs away when there's ibadah. The hadith says that when the adhan goes, the devil runs away. Why? Because this is an open invitation towards Allah. So he cannot hear the adhan. It's too much for him to bear. And he flees away. And the hadith says that while fleeing, he's even passing wind out of fear when he's hearing the adhan. And by the way, the term that is used in the hadith, وَلَهُ ضُرَاطٌ, that is the phrase that is used. In Arabic, this is the beauty of Arabic. This is not the only example. There's many more examples, but just because it comes to mind. When a person passes wind, if it's silent and violent, it's called fusa. And Allah forbid, if it's loud and proud, it's called durat. So they are separate words. The word that is used is durat. Anyway, the devil runs away. So this person entered this home behind this girl. And then he had a flash of the verse of the Quran. Allahu Akbar. This is piety, this is taqwa. Wallah, this is taqwa. May Allah grant it to us. This is the object of the month of Ramadan. What is taqwa? This is taqwa. That a person is about to engage and indulge with a woman of phenomenal beauty, of a high lineage. He did not run before her. She's been constantly inviting him. So all of the dimensions are in place for you to have a ball of a time. And then the hadith, the narration of Ibn Kathir says, he had a flash of the verse of the Quran. That is taqwa. When you are being in, Allah forbid, Allah forgive, we are in namaz. And what flashes we having in our mind? And an old number comes to mind. Many years ago I heard it. That is why one scholar was told, somebody came to me and said, Sheikh, I have a problem. I think of my wife all the time in namaz. So that scholar told him, you're fortunate. There are others that are thinking of other people's wives in namaz. So what is our condition? We are not conscious of Allah in the hub of ibadat. In the masjid, in my sajda. In Masjidul Haram, in my sajda, I cannot think about Allah. Here's a man in seclusion with a woman of phenomenal beauty. What's the flesh that he has? إِنَّ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا إِذَا مَسَّهُمْ طَائِفٌ مِّنَ الشَّيْطَانِ تَذَكَّرُوا فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْصِرُونَ. The pious are those, when the devil whispers an evil thought, they reflect and introspect. فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْصِرُونَ, and they restrain from the disobedience of Allah. The narration of Ibn Kathir says, when he reflected over this verse, خَرَّ مَغْشِيًّا عَلَيْهِ, he fell down unconscious. That's taqwa. That means, for me, you know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu, and somebody came and insulted him, he remained silent. And a person came and again violated him, and he remained silent. And after this happened multiple times, the Prophet Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu responded. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam excused himself. Abu Bakr said, O Nabi of Allah, did I not have the right to respond? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, as long as you were silent, Jibreel was responding on your behalf. When you decided to respond, Jibreel excused himself. So I said, let me also leave. And then he said, Siddiq wala'an kalla wa rabbil ka'ba. Siddiq wala'an kalla wa rabbil ka'ba. One side you are Abu Bakr Siddiq, and one side you are using foul language. By the Lord of the Ka'ba, there can be no harmony between these two. That's what, when I'm going towards zina, Allah protect me. There's Iman and Quran in my heart. One side I'm reciting Surah Fatiha, and one side it's zina. One side I'm making sajda, and one side it's riba and interest. One side I'm giving charity, and on the other hand I'm disobedient to my parents. Kalla wa rabbil ka'ba. The Iman of my heart needs to tell me that these two don't go in hand. If I am entering that place and that hub of sin, my inner Iman needs to tell me, you do not belong here. You need to, Allah forbid, we feel like strangers in the masjid. We need to feel like strangers in the environments of sin. وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَشْهَدُونَ الزُّورِ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَشْهَدُونَ. May Allah protect us from all evil places. those that do not attend gatherings and functions of evil. وَإِذَا مَرُّوا بِاللَّغْوِ مَرُّوا كِرَامًا. If they perchance happen to pass by an evil gathering, they hasten their pace simply because they are uncomfortable in an environment of the disobedience of Allah. I'm ending with this narration. This is taqwa. May Allah Ta'ala grant it to us. May Allah make us from amongst those that protect our gaze. May Allah grant us chastity and iffah. May Allah grant our women folk chastity and iffah, inshallah. So he was carried, فَحُمِلَ إِلَىٰ بَيْتِ أَبِيهِ. He was carried to his dad's home. And when he regained his consciousness, the father asked him, oh my son, imagine what a fortunate father that was. Your son fell unconscious and he's thinking of a verse of the Quran. He said, وَأَيَّ آيَةٍ قَرَأْتَ يَا بُنَيَّ. Oh my son, I'm green with envy for you. Could you just share with me the secret? Which verse did you reflect over that made you fall unconscious? So he said, oh my dad, it was this verse. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا إِذَا مَسَّهُمْ طَائِفٌ مِّنَ الشَّيْطَانِ. The pious ones are those that when the devil whispers an evil message, then they reflect and they restrain from the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The narration of Ibn Kathir says he read this verse for a second time to his father and he fell unconscious, not to stand up till the day of Qiyamah. That's the effect of taqwa. And then his janazah was performed and he was buried in the Muslim Qabrastan. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu was informed and he said, why did you not inform me? I would have been part of the burial of this lad. And then Umar radiallahu anhu came to the grave. This is the virtue of taqwa. We don't have it. We're bereft of taqwa and piety. May Allah grant it to us all in this month of Ramadan. Say ameen, brothers. Through our humble efforts, through our broken fast, we make dua to Allah. Allah gives us this taqwa. Allah gives us this pleasure of ibadat. When I open my Quran, there must be solace. When I put my head in sajda, there must be comfort and peace. May Allah grant it to us. Umar radiallahu anhu came to the grave of this man, this young boy. And he said, Abshir ya ghulam. وَلِمَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ جَنَّتَانِ. Glad tidings to you, O my young boy. Listen, this is the promise of my Allah. For the one that has taqwa like that which you had, Allah will give him two jannats. The narration is recorded in Ibn Kathir. The young boy responded from his grave and he said, قَدْ أَعْطَانِيهِمَا رَبِّي. Umar, you are speaking of theory. I am witnessing reality. Allah has already shown me my two jannats. May Allah Ta'ala grant us the quality of taqwa. May Allah Ta'ala make us from amongst those that stay away from the disobedience of Allah. And may Allah make us from those fortunate ones that truly experience the sweetness of Iman and the pleasure of Quran. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.